You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
My son was in the Army back during Desert Storm, but even then he wanted an MBA. He looked at a dozen schools, but only one offered the online education and flexibility he needed while he was in a tent in Iraq, Grantham University. Turns out that Grantham's been delivering affordable, relevant college and advanced degrees for over 65 years. Heck, if they can deliver a quality education to a soldier in a tent overseas, think about the flexibility Grantham can offer you so you can earn your degree too. It doesn't matter how complicated or full your life is, if getting a degree is on your bucket list, you'll want to do what my son did. You'll want to call Grantham. Find out how easy it is to get started on your education so you can check that college degree off your bucket list. Call Grantham right now. 800-910-1370. That's 800-910-1370. Flexible, affordable, relevant. Call 800-910-1370.
Attention business owners and independent contractors. This is a money-saving message from Tax Mediation Services. If your business owes $20,000 or more in taxes, we can help you today, right now. Listen, dealing with the IRS is no picnic. It's an intimidating and extremely stressful process, and you don't want to go it alone. Our attorneys know every law, every tax break, and every possible opportunity to help you resolve and reduce your tax debt. And if you owe more than $20,000, you may be at the top of their hit list. So don't take your tax debt lightly, because it will not go away on its own. The IRS can seize your bank accounts, your home, and even shut down your business. Call our tax experts today at 1-800-783-0810 and let us deal with the IRS while you focus on your business. That's 1-800-783-0810. Again, that's 800-783-0810.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
Ready to stand out? Army ROTC prepares you not only as a college student, but as a strong leader, allowing you to earn the rank of second lieutenant. You will be eligible for full tuition merit-based scholarships and develop leadership skills essential for your future. Start strong and enhance your college experience. Visit your campus Army ROTC representative today. To find out how you can earn up to a full tuition scholarship, visit goarmy.com/podcast to locate your closest ROTC program today. Army officers inspire strength in others. Paid for by the United States Army.
The following program contains coarse language and adult themes. Listener discretion is advised.
I take a breath, I'm not gonna lose. This is what I came here to do.
Keep on doing what you do, Rick. You're my favorite host. Favorite.
I have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass. And I'm all out of bubblegum.
It's time to hear the truth about America's biggest challenges. You're listening to America Off the Rails with your host, Rick Robinson.
Well, good Sunday evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the program. I am Rick Robinson. This is America Off the Rails. We are your closing act for the Sunday night lineup here on KLRNradio.com. And, the funny thing is, I keep thinking about changing the intro and having somebody else do the what in the business is called the branding. But I just the thing about it is first of all, I know I say this every so often, but I had no idea how prophetic the title of this program was going to be when I came up with the title of this program. And it actually started as a Facebook page. It was the Facebook page is titled America is Coming Off the Rails. When I launched the podcast, it kind of became the foregone conclusion that we've already come off the rails. And if anything, the longer I've been doing this, the more I've realized that that's fairly accurate. The funniest thing is that, you know, here we are and it's 2024. And we've talked about how matrixy 2024 feels. I mean, you know, leap year, which is common for election years for some reason. I don't really understand why they decided. I feel like there's something like otherworldly about that, where election, you know, major elections have to be held on leap years. I kind of feel like there's some sort of like masonry correlation there or something I need to look into at some point, but that may or may not be a future juxtaposition episode if that comes to fruition. So where to start? All right, so I guess we might as well start here. Ladies and gentlemen, no matter how anybody tries to spin it for you, 2024, as far as the election goes, is shaping up to be the biggest crap sandwich we've ever been fed. And you have an option between crap sandwich A and crap sandwich B. And no matter which toppings you put on said crap sandwich that you decide to pick, it's still going to be a crap sandwich. The problem is, for some reason, everybody's decided they want Geriatric Grudge Match 2.0. And when I say everybody, I don't necessarily mean all of you folks listening, because a lot of you are like, can we stop electing people to office that shouldn't be buying green bananas? And that happens to be a stance that I firmly support. But here we are with 2024 coming right at us. And so far, it's very glitch in the matrixy, because, you know, it's election year. It's a leap year. We had the same teams in the Super Bowl, generally the same outcome of the teams in the Super Bowl. And now, thanks to Super Tuesday, it looks like it's going to be Biden versus Trump. And of course, everybody is picking their side. But the thing that I keep trying to make everybody understand, and the thing that I can't seem to make everybody understand, is if we don't put somebody at the head of the country that is willing to close the border, it's not going to matter whether we have a GOP or not anymore. Now, folks, this is something that I've been trying to explain for a very, very long time, and it's taken them over 100 years to get to this point. Hillary Clinton was supposed to be the nail in the American coffin. Why do you think they tried so hard to derail Trump? Why do you think, and again, you know, I know I go over this a lot, but I feel like I have to, because I feel like nobody's caught on yet. Bill Clinton asked Donald Trump to run against his wife. If that wasn't the biggest signal that the fix was in somehow, and that he was supposed to take it on the chin, and he didn't, which is why they have come after him with all of the hounds of hell ever since, and they are not stopping. But here's the point that I can't seem to make anybody else understand. If January 6th was really about what they say it was about, it would have died after Trump got out of office. The fact that they are still coming after not only everybody that was there, but anybody that tried to cover it. I mean, the DOJ just perp-walked a journalist for covering January 6th. I need you to hear me when I say this again. The DOJ just perp-walked a journalist who covered January 6th, and the mainstream media isn't even referring to him as a journalist. They are referring to him as an up-jump blogger who works for the police. Ladies and gentlemen, journalism doesn't mean what you think it means anymore. If you are not carrying the administration's water, then you are not considered a journalist. And if you are not carrying the administration's water, then you're considered a traitor to the state. I need you to understand that Biden is everything that he's been warning us against and claiming it was Trump. Everything. the Democrats are everything they have always projected onto the Republicans. They are still the racist. Look at Joe Biden. Look at Joe Biden. I mean, these people are coming after Trump for things that he did 15, 20 years ago. But you go back 20 years ago in Biden's record and he did terrible things. Oh, but he had a reformation moment, Rick. You have to understand, he realized the error of his ways and he made changes. Really, then can you explain to me why he referred to Barack Obama in some of the most racist language that I have ever heard? And then Bill Clinton said, you know, a few years ago, that boy would have been getting me my coffee. The Democrats are everything they have tried to tell you that you are, if you're a conservative. And it is time that we stop being afraid of that. Ladies and gentlemen, this is not an easy conversation, but it's something that, it's a conversation that we need to have. Because the whole point is, January 6th would not have been anything that they have made it out to be if the FBI wasn't neck deep in it. So you have to ask yourself, why was the FBI neck deep in it? Why was the FBI neck deep in trying to orchestrate the kidnapping of a Democratic governor? Why were these things happening? These are things that you see in freaking evil villain movies like James Bond. Why are they happening on American soil? And why are the institutions that we have been indoctrinated and ingrained to trust because they are supposed to protect us, the ones trying to destroy us from the inside? Nobody wants to talk about it. Maybe they're afraid of the black helicopters. Maybe they're afraid that there's, you know, going to be red lights on their chest if they say too much. I don't know. I don't care. Ladies and gentlemen, if we do not close the border, it won't matter whether the Republican Party still exists. And that's all I keep hearing from everybody that is so diametrically opposed to Donald Trump. And again, please believe me when I tell you this. I am not telling you who you should vote for. But I am telling you that if you are standing on your principles while the Titanic is sinking and you do nothing about it, what's the point? We're busily arguing about rearranging the deck chairs while our country is basically hit an iceberg. Nobody wants to admit it. Nobody wants to talk about it. Oh, we can survive 4 more years of Biden. We can, because I've barely survived 3. Can we really survive another 4 years of this? Will it even take another 4 years for the people that want this country to collapse to be able to finish doing what they've been trying to do since before 1913? These are the things that we need to start talking about openly. Because here's what pisses me off. We always say this. I want somebody who will get elected into office and tell us the truth, no matter what it is, no matter how hard it is, or run for office and tell us the truth, no matter how hard it is, until they do. Because, ladies and gentlemen, the people that are telling you that the 2020 election wasn't stolen are full of they're full of crap. The 2020 election was stolen in front of our eyes. And if you were watching it that night, you know it too. You may not want to admit it to yourself, but you know it. I had an entire team with me and all of us. There was one point where every single one of us was speechless. None of us could say anything when the reports started coming in about all the different jurisdictions. They were like, yeah, we're done counting and we're going to resume sometime like 9 o'clock in the morning. And then I wake up the next day super early and they've already figured out that Joe Biden was the winner because the ballot fairy showed up in the middle of the night. So, again, I've been saying this for weeks because as soon as the writing was on the wall, and I knew it was when DeSantis dropped out, I have no idea why he dropped out as early as he did, but there has to be something that he knew that we didn't, because he was probably the only one that may have still had a shot. Haley did not have a prayer. I don't know who told her she did. I don't know why she stayed in as long as she did. I don't know what the plan is. Maybe they're going to try to resurrect her under some, you know, maybe there'll be another third-party attempt. I don't know. And then the other weird thing is I keep seeing all this stuff about RFK Jr. trying to run as libertarian. He can't. He's already running as an independent. They can't just draft him into the Libertarian Party. That's not how any of this works. I mean, I guess they could try. I mean, it's not like libertarians have a lot of rules. I was surprised to find out that for the first time ever, the Libertarian Party was actually trying to hold primaries. Most of the time, it's just this foregone conclusion, and they just have some sort of an anointing, or they did, at their convention, but they actually did have a primary this year. So I was looking, I mean, they had like 15, 20 people on their ballot. The last I checked, the person that was leading their part, their nomination process is somebody I've never even heard of before. And I say that as a registered libertarian, but I mean, again, I became a libertarian as a protest vote in 2015. That's why I'm telling you, I'm not telling you who to vote for, but I am telling you that this whole thing that both sides do now, where they vote based on feeling instead of logic, is going to get us killed. We are going to be destroyed before our very eyes. Well, I'd rather go down standing on principle. You know, that's really a great thing to say until you're staring down the barrel of a gun. Figuratively and literally. And if you don't believe how close we are to that, I need to remind you that the sitting president of the United States has called half the country traitors more than once. Do you really think if he gets another 4 years that internment camps are very far off? I don't. And I don't say that out of hyperbole. And I don't say that to piss you off. And I don't say that to scare you. I'm just telling you what I see. Because what I've been trying to tell you guys for years is both parties are basically the same now. That's why Donald Trump got so much traction in 2015, 2016. He was the guy standing on the debate stage when Hillary Clinton was like, and he doesn't pay his fair share of taxes. He's like, you're right, I don't. I use the tax code. You don't like how much taxes I pay? Change the tax code. But you know what? You won't, because your same donors use that same tax code. That's why I laugh my ass off every time I hear somebody like Joe Biden, we're going to make sure millionaires and billionaires, and they don't even say millionaires and billionaires anymore, because they can't, because almost everybody in Congress is at least a millionaire at this point. So now it's, we're going to make sure billionaires pay their fair share. We're going to set a 25% tax rate. No, you're not. You can set it at that, but you're not going to change the business tax code, which is why when you get enough money, you turn your family into a corporation. You know how I know? Because I've been taking lessons from people that have done that. You can literally file an LLC under your name for about $500 and the cost of an insurance policy. And at that point, once you say you put out a... You take 30 seconds and scroll out a book on Amazon, even if it never sells, technically you've started a business. And yes, that is a dirty way to do it. But I'm telling you, they do it because they use the tax code to their advantage. And that's, nobody had seen anybody like Donald Trump before. When Donald Trump, when he looked at Hillary Clinton and said, yes, I use the tax code, that was this century's version of Ronald Reagan. I promise not to use the youth of my candidate to my advantage. I don't remember exactly what he said, but it was something pretty close to that. That was that moment for Trump. Because everybody was like, oh my God, he's admitting it. Nobody's ever admitted that before. There's plenty of people that know it, but nobody's admitted it. And that's part of the reason why they hated him so much. He was pulling back the curtain in the city of Oz. He's like, here, take a look. Look, they all do it. You know why nobody wants to do business in New York anymore? Because Letitia James went after one of the biggest business names in New York City and is trying to bankrupt him for doing the same thing that they all do, and he didn't do a damn thing wrong. This is the part that I get it. We're all on 1040s. So we don't understand the complexities of the tax code. And unless you're making enough money where you feel it's necessary to hire an accountant, then you're not going to start understanding the tax code. And this is something else that blew my mind, that I've said this before. I got on this kick of watching the Dick Van Dyke Show on Peacock about 6-8 months ago now. because it dropped one day, and it was because Dick Van Dyke had a spot on Days of Our Lives for about 2 or 3 months, and so they brought the Dick Van Dyke show back, and I remember being floored that a guy that was a TV producer and basically middle class had an accountant, because every other episode, well, I talked to the accountant today, and we're going to have to cut some corners, and we're going to have to do this, we're going to have to do that. I was like, damn, did everybody have an accountant in the 50s? Was it really the golden age that everybody says it was? Because it kind of sounds like it was. Everybody had retirement plans. You didn't have to work until you were 90, and you had an accountant to help you manage your money. But that's when people were still being taught about finances. They don't want you to be taught those things. But the worst thing about all of this, everything that we're talking about, is the fact that behind the scenes where you can't see it, where Donald Trump started pulling back the curtain in the city of Oz, there is a group that is met in the middle from both parties that hate you and me. Because they've made it and they want to be gatekeepers. And if you don't think they're gatekeepers, I need you to look at everything that's come out about Hollywood. Because Hollywood has gatekeepers. I guarantee you, DC has gatekeepers, because you're not good enough to be here. And it happens with rich people too, because you have old money, and then you have new money, and old money hates new money, and new money hates old money, because old money's like Thurston Howell III. New money's Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. Never the two shall meet. But that's they hate you. And you know how I know they hate you? This is from Town Hall. This was written today. Here's the evidence Liz Cheney tried to bury during the January 6th probe. I can't say this is surprising. And at this point, I'm reading the article. I'll let you know if I start adding them. I can't say that this is surprising. Still, it provides another chance to take a swipe at former Rep. Liz Cheney, supposed Republican Wyoming, who the Federalist has busted for suppressing exculpatory evidence concerning the ongoing anti-Trump narrative that the former president orchestrated some violent coup on January 6th. One bit of proof Cheney didn't want to be widely publicized is that the Trump administration's security plans, which included 10,000 National Guard troops to protect Washington, D.C., they had one, and the city rejected it. These revelations were gleaned from an interview with Deputy Chief of Staff Anthony Ornato, who heard conversations between White House Chief of Staff Mark Meadows and D.C. Mayor Muriel Bowser. Meadows wanted the city to request whatever they needed to keep the city secure. Cheney was reportedly present for these interviews. Molly Hemingway has more. Cheney and her committee falsely claimed they had no evidence to support Trump's officials' claim that the White House had communicated its desire for 10,000 National Guard troops. In fact, an early transcribed interview conducted by the committee included precisely that evidence from a key source. The interview, which Cheney attended and personally participated in, was suppressed from public release until now. Deputy Chief of Staff Ornato's first transcribed interview with the committee was conducted on January 28, 2022. In it, he told Cheney and her investigators that he overheard White House Chief of Staff Mark Meadows push Washington, D.C. Mayor Muriel Bowser to request as many National Guard troops as she needed to protect the city. He also testified President Trump had suggested 10,000 would be needed to keep the peace at the public rallies and protests scheduled for January 6, 2021. Ornato also described White House frustration with Acting Secretary of Defense Christopher Miller's slow deployment of assistance on the afternoon of January 6, 2021. Not only did the committee not accurately characterize the interview, they suppressed the transcript from public review. On top of that, committee allies began publishing critical stories and even conspiracy theories about Ornato ahead of follow-up interviews with him. Ornato was a career Secret Service official who had been detailed to the security position in the White House. Ornato said White House concerns about January 6th were related to fears that left-wing groups would clash with Trump protesters and that no one in the White House anticipated a riot at the Capitol. Antifa and other left-wing groups were planning protests for the same day. Left-wing groups had been involved in violent assaults on Trump supporters following public protest. Bowser's decision to decline help from the White House did not end the Trump team's efforts to secure troops ahead of the protest. When the D.C. mayor declined Trump's offer of 10,000 troops, Ornato said the White House requested a quick reaction force out of the Defense Department in case it was needed. Once the Capitol was breached, the Trump White House pushed for immediate help from Acting Secretary of Defense Christopher Miller and grew frustrated at the slow deployment of that help, according to the testimony. So then I remember the chief saying, "Hey, I'm calling Secretary of Defense to get the QRF ready in here," Ornato said. Later he said, and then I remember the chief telling Miller, "Get them in here, get them in here to secure the Capitol now." This anti-Trump circus has many twists and turns. Trump is a moron, but so crafty he orchestrated a violent takeover of the Capitol to prevent the peaceful transition of power. He's irresponsible with state secrets, but it is the greatest known threat to the Republic. He wanted to foment rebellion, but requested 10,000 troops to secure the Capitol. He's fascist, but he also willingly left office in January of 2021. The left needs to pick one narrative and stick with it. Trump gets the same illogical treatment liberals apply to most issues. The other one where they routinely crash into their own walls is gun control, where the consensus is that only police can be trusted with firearms. However, they're also the ones committing some covert genocide against people of color or something. Don't think about it too long. You'll get a migraine trying to make sense of it. Cheney didn't want to play this game. She just buried it. Cheney would later get buried by voters in her home state, who booted her for her anti-Trump antics. They don't like you. They want you to be serfs. And we are dangerously close to being there. I've been telling you guys for weeks. We don't have freedoms anymore. We have illusions of freedoms. You don't believe me? Try to go fishing without a license. See what happens if you get caught. Drive for a couple weeks without a seatbelt. See what happens. If this were a free country, you could still basically do whatever you wanted to do, whenever you wanted to do it, and only really have to answer to yourselves or the immediate people that you have a responsibility to. We haven't been a free country or a free people in over 100 years. And the people that have managed to wrangle control, and it's taken them over 100 years to do it, do not want to give it back. That's why they hate Trump. And I'm not telling you that Trump is not part of that problem. But I will tell you that Donald Trump is a smart enough businessman to understand that the economy needs to be able to work for him to be able to make the money that, for the lifestyle that he is accustomed to, which will be a benefit to the rest of us. So this is going to be my take before we go to break, and I've put this all over social media for the last several days, because I get it. A lot of you hate Donald Trump. I understand that. I've never met the man. I don't know if I would like him if we ever got a chance to meet face to face. But I do know that for 3 of the 4 years that he was in office, our economy was firing on all cylinders. We had jobs coming back to America. Everybody I knew was getting raises willingly from the companies that they worked for. A burger from Five Guys was not $23 and some change. I mean, do you realize how many fast food restaurants are going to go out of business if something doesn't change? Because nobody can afford to eat there anymore. You know, the funny thing is, when the economy first started crashing, it was actually cheaper to eat out than it was to buy groceries. I just bought groceries today. I bought enough groceries for five dinners and some quick lunches. Five dinners. And basically sandwiches and some cereal. And five dinners. And I spent over $130 today. In Oklahoma. For basically a week's worth of food. $130. And that was cutting corners. That was bare essentials. It's crazy. These people want you beholden to them. And we have an entire generation who's been raised up to be that way. And if you think they hate you, or you think they like you, I need you to remember that someone who supposedly shares the same values as most of us listening, most of you listening to this show right now, hid the truth from you. regarding Donald Trump and January 6th. So the worst thing is, she wasn't the only one. Part of Nancy Pelosi's security detail lied about where he was and has been busted on video. Why is he not up on charges for perjury? Is it too late? Can we fix this mess? I don't know. But I know that if we keep fighting amongst ourselves and keep leading with our emotions, there's not going to be anything left to save. So please, let's keep fighting over where the deck chairs are on the Titanic as it sinks. It's a great plan. Great plan. All right, going to break. I don't know what I want to go to break with, though. This one seems fitting. All right, we'll be right back. You are listening to America Off the Rails. I am your host, Rick Robinson. Second half coming at you on the other side. Stay tuned. Never let them get inside your head. They'll tell you what to do in life instead of everything you know that you could get. Don't let them guide your life towards regret. I'll fight for what I love with every breath. My past is filled with things I won't forget. I use them all to push me to my best. So treat the worst of times just like a test. If only I could go back in time, I'd tell myself that everything will end up alright. Just push yourself.
You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
My son was in the Army back during Desert Storm, but even then he wanted an MBA. He looked at a dozen schools, but only one offered the online education and flexibility he needed while he was in a tent in Iraq. Grantham University. Turns out that Grantham's been delivering affordable, relevant college and advanced degrees for over 65 years. Heck, if they can deliver a quality education to a soldier in a tent overseas, think about the flexibility Grantham can offer you so you can earn your degree too. It doesn't matter how complicated or full your life is, if getting a degree is on your bucket list, you'll want to do what my son did. You'll want to call Grantham. Find out how easy it is to get started on your education so you can check that college degree off your bucket list. Call Grantham right now. 800-910-1370. That's 800-910-1370. Flexible, affordable, relevant. Call 800-910-1370.
Attention business owners and independent contractors. This is a money-saving message from Tax Mediation Services. If your business owes $20,000 or more in taxes, we can help you today, right now. Listen, dealing with the IRS is no picnic. It's an intimidating and extremely stressful process, and you don't want to go it alone. Our attorneys know every law, every tax break, and every possible opportunity to help you resolve and reduce your tax debt. And if you owe more than $20,000, you may be at the top of their hit list. So don't take your tax debt lightly, because it will not go away on its own. The IRS can seize your bank accounts, your home, and even shut down your business. Call our tax experts today at 1-800-783-0810 and let us deal with the IRS while you focus on your business. That's 1-800-783-0810. Again, that's 800-783-0810.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
The following program contains coarse language and adult themes. Listener discretion is advised.
Oh. king's back and the throne's mine. The future's here and it's my time. Straight shot, going for the head with it. Take his head off and say that I did it. Good riddance. Say hi to the bad guy, I'm back in business. If you took what's mine, I'm back to get it. There's nothing you can do, I'm back with vengeance.
Now turn me loose. Welcome back into the program, ladies and gentlemen. All right, so a couple of quick hits from the chat that are tied into one of the things I wanted to talk about. We ran out of time before the break. So first things first, if Trump was the dictator that everybody claims he was, why didn't he go ahead and build the wall anyway after his own party stopped them from doing it? You know, like Biden has with the whole Supreme Court saying, hey, you can't forgive student loan debt. And he's like, yeah, hold my beer and watch. Or I guess in his case, hold my pudding and watch. If Donald Trump was the dictator that everyone claims, why didn't he have Mike Pence shot in the head and then refuse to leave office? I mean, I'm sure somebody probably would have followed the order. Might have taken him a minute to find somebody willing to do it, but I'm almost willing to bet somebody would have followed the order. But again, Donald Trump willingly left office. Did he do anything or put any policies in place to make it harder for the next president to do their job? Because guess who has done that? Joe Biden. So, Jeff, you're right. They are starting to take steps to make it harder for the next person to do their job if it happens to not be Joe Biden. Because Donald Trump, unfortunately, loves to telegraph his moves, and I really wish he would stop. I get it. It's how he gets his voters riled up. I'm going to go in there and I'm going to get rid of all the establishment pricks in D.C. Well, guess what? Now Joe Biden has made that next to impossible. Sounds kind of dictatorish, doesn't it? Because he's taking steps through executive order to make sure that whoever the next president is, and probably the next president after that one, can't really do anything to downsize the executive administrative area. Is the administrative part of the executive branch. So yeah, they are starting to set it up to where it doesn't really matter who the president is. And really, honestly, for the longest time, the president's basically been a figurehead. Nobody wants to admit it. They have consolidated a lot of power within the bureaucracy of the executive branch. And Donald Trump was starting to undo that. That's another reason why they came after him as hard as they did. If we ever got a peek to see everything that he had actually done, everybody's going to be pissed off at me when I say this, but it probably would have. Can we get rid of that amendment that says that a president can only serve two terms? I guarantee you, if we ever got the truth about everything that was coming at him and everybody that was trying to stop him and all the things that he managed to do anyway, it probably would have been one of those things, if not for COVID, and if not for him. I mean, still today even, he's still taking victory laps over the COVID vaccine. Just stop. Just stop. It didn't even do what everybody told us it was going to do. And you could have stopped so much of this animus from the people that used to be on your side by just explaining that you got suckered. But you can't do that. Because a narcissist can't admit when they're wrong. And ladies and gentlemen, whether you like it or not, whether you want to admit it or not, pretty much everybody who runs for office, and for the most part tries to become a public figure, has a little bit of streak of narcissism. Because they feed off of the attention. Now, Donald Trump is an overt narcissist, and he doesn't even try to hide it. Then you've got the covert narcissists. Those are the really dangerous ones, because at the time you don't even realize they are till it's too late. But anyway, I digress, and we're running out of time. So, yeah, unfortunately, they are starting to take steps to make sure that if the next president, especially if the next president isn't Biden, it's going to be a lot harder for the next president to do his job. And if they had passed that border, hear the air quotes, security bill, it was an amnesty bill wrapped in border security, because the border security part was basically a lie. All it did was add a whole bunch of door greeters and ticket takers. And yes, it was a very strong build to a point, one of the better ones that has been put out in a while on the surface until you got into the back pages. But if they had passed that monstrosity, then it would have made it even harder for the next not open borders favored president to do their job. So yeah, they are systematically taking steps to make it harder. Which is why I'm saying the damage at this point is almost done. And I don't even know if we can stop it anymore. But I don't know what we do other than try either. It's pretty much where I am right now. We gotta try somehow. Alright, so what if I told you the West was fucking retarded? So, it's going to take me a second to find it because I forgot to send it back to myself. But I have something that I want you guys to listen to, and that hopefully it doesn't take me more than a minute or so to find. So hang on. Wait, it didn't take as long as I thought. Alright, so this is a short clip from Glenn Beck's program. As soon as it lets me log back into Facebook. Eventually.
Two of the biggest funders of the radical transgender movement in America are actually Chinese-based billionaires. One of them is Roy Singham. His organization, through the People's Forum, has done a lot. The other one is Joe Tsai. Joe Tsai is the co-founder of Alibaba.
Are either of them just big fans of trans?
They are not trans themselves. There's no evidence. They have family members that are trans. But here, I think, is the kicker, Glenn. Both of them advocate strongly for these rights in the United States. They never bring them up in China. Both of them take pro-CCP positions. To the toe of the party line, there's no divergence. And the CCP has said they don't even want effeminate characters on television because it's going to demasculate China. So it seems to me quite absurd to say, I love the CCP, I'm all in.
Yeah.
But I'm in favor of these trans rights. I think the more logical explanation is they view this as a form of warfare against the United States. Two of the biggest funders of the...
All right, so, yeah, what if I told you that two of the biggest backers of the whole transgender movement were Chi-Coms? Now, I'm not saying that, you know, that North Korea may not be involved in some way or form or fashion. I'm not even saying Russia may not be involved in some way, form, or fashion. But what if I told you that our own need and desire to be accepting has been weaponized against us? Because it has. It's the funniest thing ever, because if you talk to people that live in China about TikTok, it is used for education purposes. It is used to teach math, science, all the things that it should be being used for here. But here, it's used to push social agendas. And it's used to push this drive for people to get paid to play on an app all day. Which is becoming more and more of a thing. Now, I'm not disparaging that. I mean, hell, the first time I saw that there was like an 8-year-old kid that was making hundreds of thousands of dollars a year on YouTube reviewing Christmas presents, I was like, damn, why didn't I think of that idea? I had cute kids way back in the day. We could have made a fortune. YouTube didn't exist back then yet, or barely was a thing, which may or may not have made it catch on even sooner. But here's the thing. We are living the scorpion and the frog parable on so many fronts, and nobody wants to admit it. Nobody wants to talk about it. Nobody wants to accept it. I mean, there's a handful of us out there. I see people that pick up my posts when I start railing about China being involved in the transgendering of America. I see people, when I point out that the Cold War never ended, it just became an insurgency, latching onto that and running with it, because it's the truth of it. At the end of World War II, we may have beat the Nazis, but we imported a lot of them back here because we wanted their science. You don't think some of that ideology stayed around? Do you not realize that, and I believe it was Khrushchev himself, that once said that the USSR is never going to beat America from the outside, but it will likely defeat us from the inside. And if you wonder if that was a prophetic statement, I need you to do me a favor. Google the following phrase. How many people below the age of 30 believe communism is the best choice? I think you'll be surprised by that number. Because they infiltrated our education system. The progressive income tax is communism. You can't say that anymore without somebody shouting you down. But Marx himself said that a progressive income tax is the doorway to implementing communist policy. Which makes you wonder why they wanted it so badly here. And why was it that so many things that made us free-range people on a tax farm all happened right around the same time as World War II? Has anybody else wondered that? Has anybody wondered that? Because I honestly have to admit, I'm starting to wonder that. All these things happened in 1913. Like, within succession of each other. The Federal Reserve still had a bit of a leash on it until we completely decoupled from the gold standard. Then suddenly there was an unlimited credit card, and it didn't matter because our kids were going to pay for it and our grandkids were going to pay for it. Well, guess what? Those bills are coming due. And now instead of us paying those bills, we are sending money overseas to have it laundered. And the politicians that are supposed to work for us are getting rich off of it. These people are supposed to work for us. That is what I've been taught my whole life. But the irony of it is, we have worked for them for as long as I've been alive. Why do you think they try so hard to go after what they call the gig economy? They need you on a W-2. If they have you on a W-2, they can control you more. Because then you don't have so many of the advantages of the tax code. Because the tax code is designed, and I'm pretty sure it was on purpose, because we've talked about this on the Rick Robinson Show. Republicans gave us progressive income tax. They didn't do it on purpose, I don't think. But they're the ones that gave it to us, because there was a short taxation thing going on for a while around the Civil War, and then that one went away. And then the Democrats, every 2 years since, kept coming back to the well. We need a progressive income tax. We need a progressive income tax. We need a progressive income tax. And the Republicans kept saying, no, 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 no. No. So it was like the old cartoon with the big bulldog and the little terrier or chihuahua or whatever it was. Where are we going today, Spike? What are we doing today, Spike? And eventually Spike would just get pissed off and punch the shit out of the dog and keep walking. Well, eventually the Republicans got tired of punching the shit out of the terrier. So they said, fine. We will put it to a vote of the people. We will send it to the states. And if enough states ratify it, we will make it an amendment to the Constitution that we have a progressive income tax, because it's the only way it will ever become legal and permanent. The Republicans at the time were surely thinking that people were not stupid enough to give up their own hard-earned money with no say in where it was going, because we had the most Republican form of taxation ever before that. If the government had a port project they wanted to get done, you bought the bonds for it. If they wanted to go to war, you bought the bonds for it. So you had direct veto power with your wallet. Guess what? You don't have that anymore. They took it from you. We are the batteries powering the very machine that we have been railing against for as long as I have been alive. And the most ironic thing of all is when the income tax was passed in 1913, it was 1 or 2%. look at where it is now. There have been times, because I remember my granddad griping way, way, way back in the day, because in the 70s it was upwards of somewhere between 60 to 75%. Because it's communism. It's collectivism. And it doesn't work. It doesn't fix anything. All it did was give the government an unlimited line of credit so that it could start growing out of control. Our government, as Ordy Packard likes to call it, was very minarchist until 1913 because it had to stay small. It couldn't be a Leviathan because it needed funding and it didn't have it. So they figured out how to make it happen. First, the progressive income tax. Then a centralized banking system with wrapping it in the flag so it seemed like it was a government agency, but it's actually just a private bank. Then they made it possible for that private bank to print more money whenever it needed to, within reason, because everything was still tied to the gold standard. Until Nixon. And that's when, basically, we definitely became free-range humans on a tax farm. And then they took the rest of your freedoms away with the Patriot Act, and most of us don't even know it yet. Anyway, we are just about out of time. One more quick hit, though, because I have to talk about this. So I don't know about you guys, but I had no idea. So somehow I missed a Rocky movie. So I remember Rocky IV, and then I remember Rocky V. And then I remember when Creed came out, because I missed one somewhere. So because by the time Creed came out, you know, Talia Shire's character had already been killed off, and they, of course, showed some of the flashbacks. But I didn't realize that those flashbacks that they were showing were from Rocky Balboa, which was filmed in 2006, which somehow I never saw until probably 2-3 weeks ago. But anyway, I digress a little bit. There's a point here, trust me. So the other day, I see this post, right, about Mike Tyson. I don't even remember the name of the guy that he's fighting against. I probably should have looked it up. But the funniest thing about this is Mike Tyson, who's like 57 years old, and honestly, I had no idea we were that close in age, but I guess we are, has decided that he's going to hold a match with some white dude who's fought like maybe 15, 20 times, I think. And the irony of this is the exact plot of Rocky Balboa. But the genders are reversed. So Rocky, or not genders, but races are reversed. So Rocky, you know, at this point is like in his 50s. His only kid is an adult. He's struggling with his wife being gone. And there's this sportscast thing where they show, like, and they called it, I don't even remember what they called it. But anyway, it was a computer animated simulation where the current champion would face champions of yesteryear and see who held up best. And in this simulation, Rocky kicked the new champion's butt. Now, of course, it was Rocky in his prime versus this champion in his prime. But, of course, this sent the new champion all sideways, blah, 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 yada, yada, yada. No way this old man's going to beat my butt, blah, 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 yada, yada, yada. Not going to happen. So then his promoters, because this is a guy that everybody hated at this point, and he had it kind of like, remember Rocky III when they were like, dude, every fight you've had for the last 2 years has been easy and you don't fight anybody hard anymore, and then Clubber Lang comes on the scene. So this black kid's going through like the same thing to where he's never been defeated, yada, 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 but all of his recent fights have been easy. He's a jerk that nobody really likes. So then his promoters come up with this idea of, well, if we can get him to do it, we could, you know, hold an exhibition match with Rocky. Well, unbeknownst to these guys, at the same time, Rocky, who, weirdly enough, suddenly doesn't have a brain injury anymore, which was the one big plot hole that I remembered, was cleared to get a conditional boxing license again. So then they came after him and said, you know, we could do this, and, you know, it'll be an exhibition match, it'll be 10 rounds. And the weirdest thing about this is during the whole walk-in scene, you know, how they always do where the challenger walks in first and then the champ walks in. So during the walk-in scene, Mike Tyson is cameoing in this movie, trash-talking the newest champion about, when you're done with this old guy, I'll take you on, I'll beat you, blah, 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 blah. So then the news story breaks this time last week, and all of a sudden, Mike Tyson has basically decided he wants to do the entire plot of the Rocky Balboa movie live and in person. So to me, the irony of Mike Tyson trying to recreate a movie that he cameoed in real life, with as matrixy as 2024 has been this entire time, has probably been the most 2024 thing that I have seen in ages. And the funniest thing, and I didn't even ask him if he had seen the movie yet, but when I made the joke, because I found out about this on a friend's Facebook page, Tony Barbosa, and he was like, this is a lose-lose for this guy, because the young guy, if he wins, is going to get booed and heckled for beating the crap out of an old guy. And if he loses, he's going to get booed and heckled for letting an old guy beat the crap out of him, which is basically word for word one of the lines that one of the sportscasters used in the 2006 Rocky Balboa movie. And that's when I saw the story and I saw that quote, that was the first thing that clicked. So I replied back. I didn't ask him if he'd seen the movie or not. I'm like, wait a minute, didn't Sylvester Stallone already make this movie? And then it's just something that everybody's kept talking about. I was like, this is like the most 2024 thing ever. If there was ever a 2024 thing that could be, would be Mike Tyson trying to bring this movie theme to life in real time. And that's it. If 2024 wasn't weird enough, now we have actual boxers trying to recreate movie themes. If 2024 wasn't weird enough for you yet. All right, well, believe it or not, ladies and gents, that is it. We're out of time. Hope everybody's enjoyed your Sunday night. Thank you for those of you that have hung out with us for the entire evening. I'll be back tomorrow afternoon with the Rick Robinson Show from 3 to 5. Planning on doing that all week this week, if I can, because I don't want to jinx it, because the last couple of weeks have been a little weird. And then I think we have a break from politics really for a little bit, because Super Tuesday is kind of out of the way, and I don't really think there's anything too big coming down the pike. May have some breaking stuff to kind of do here and there, but I don't see anything that's going to chew up a lot of programming in the coming few days, so we should have mostly normal programming for this week. So you guys know all that scheduled. I'm going to go through all of that because I ain't got time anyway. You can find me as the executive producer of the Loftus Party podcast, which will probably drop sometime Tuesday morning, as a contributor on Misfits Politics. One of the most recent articles that I've put out over there is actually making the rounds again, and you can find me as an occasional contributor at the Loftus Party, as well as a contributor on twitchy.com. And if you need more of me than that, and if you do, you need therapy, you could always come hang out with me on social media at RowdyRick73. But on that note, folks, I have to tell you, this particular show is over.
What? Over? Did you say over? Nothing is over until we decide it is. Was it over when the Germans bombed Pearl Harbor? Hell no!
Closing time. Open all the doors and let you out into the world.
This isn't over until I say it's over!
Closing time.
Well, that's great. That's just fucking great, man. Now what the fuck are we supposed to do? Game over, man. Game over.
Closing time. Time for you to go out to the places you will be from. Closing time. This room.